Welcome to the June She Says event with our wonderful host, Ready, Set, Rocket. Thank you for coming tonight, and obviously you guys are here because the subject matter is very true to what many of you are experiencing at the moment and want to hear from others on how do you manage that. I'm going to pass it over to Lauren Bella, who is the partner here at Ready, Set, Rocket, to sort of give the opening remarks and set the stage. So thank you for coming.
Hi, everybody. I'm Lauren Bello. I've been with RSR for about 5 years, and as employee four, I can definitely tell you a lot about shifting types of anxiety and also shifting pressures and how not to deal with anxiety in the workplace, which I've certainly been to a lot of panels where there's a lot of PR crafted responses to things, and I promise you I will be very brutally honest with you about what my experience has been like. First off, 23-year-old me wants to announce to all of you that I had a debilitating fear of public speaking. So I'm personally very proud of how I learned how to deal with that anxiety. But yeah, I mean, I was employee number four when I joined RSR. Literally, I walked into my first interview and realized that I wasn't really sure if it was a real agency. It was kind of an alleyway with one window and like three people sitting at desks, awkwardly not talking to each other and staring at me. And there's certainly a lot of pressure that comes along with that. I know a lot of you guys are probably a little more early on in your careers and probably work at agencies or at brands and, you know, have different types of stressors. And I certainly remember feeling like, for lack of better words, holy shit, every mistake I make is directly exposed to the owners of the company. Oh my God. A client exposed this issue that I had, which was probably a small thing, but I lost sleep over it for days. And then, you know, within 2 years, because I was at a small company and we happened to be growing when I joined, I became a partner. So all of a sudden I went from worrying about client escalations on a day-to-day basis to worrying about, holy crap, can we keep these people in jobs? Are we actually making a profit? Is my team actually happy in their jobs? So I would just like to say that my handling of that increased types of stress and anxiety was actually very terrible. I didn't eat well. I had a terrible work-life balance. I worked about 80 to 90 hours a week. I didn't take any vacations, and none of this was because my business partners or anyone was putting that pressure on me. I was putting that pressure on myself because I wasn't setting parameters that were healthy. So I think like the most interesting thing is thinking back, because I honestly never really like self-assessed what this transition has been like for me. A few years ago at Christmas, I was talking to my mom, who's not like the mom who's like naggy and telling you, you know, you're the worst or you need to do these things differently. She's also not the mom who's like, everything you do is amazing. She kind of keeps quiet. And basically in like nicer mom terms, she told me I looked like shit and I seemed like I was in a bad mood all the time. And that she thought I worked too much. And I basically like defended everything I was doing. Why I can't work out, why I can't eat well, why I'm working until 11 p.m., why I'm answering emails on the weekends. And then I quickly realized I sounded like a total idiot and basically was letting my job run me instead of me running my job. So I made a lot of changes, you know, started working out, started eating better, started to put parameters on my calendar, made sure I wasn't accessible to the team all the time, let clients know, and surprise, clients are actually human beings who understand that you want time off, but I wasn't available all the time. And what I realized was I wasn't just better at my day-to-day job, I was better at setting an example and being a leader in the company, because all of a sudden the team didn't feel like they had to work these crazy hours or be available on the weekends, or, you know, they felt like they should be taking vacations, they felt like they should be taking care of themselves. So it's been a really interesting ride and adventure for me personally, especially as the team and the agency grew. And there's certainly been a ton of learnings about, you know, realizing you need to have empathy as a manager, because once you become a manager, once you become a leader in any company or in any facet in life, you need to realize that your actions really impact your team and impact the people around you even more than they impact you, and that the most important thing you can do as a leader is set the right example. So I wanted to give you guys some context to what my kind of journey has been, and I certainly did not navigate it in the most graceful way, especially internally, and thank God my mom told me, or else I might still be working these crazy hours for no reason. But, you know, I think it's really interesting to think about it as it relates to the different facets of your career and as you grow, what the different types of anxieties are, but realistically, anxiety is anxiety. The stress that I have now is no different than the stress I had when I was losing sleep over potentially having to answer a question in a client meeting. And I'm really excited for you guys to meet all the panelists today who are going to be giving you guys perspectives and thoughts from very different levels of their careers. Some people, you know, are really just starting off. Some people are badass female executives who, you know, have been in the game for a really long time and talking to you about the things that they've learned and the way that they handle their stressors. So I'll throw it over to them.
Hello, everyone. Anyone have stress in their lives today? My day was crazy. I'm Gina Solapurto. I run Glue. It's a consultancy of connections and human performance in the workforce. I have a background in project management, operations, and everything in between on the agency side of things. And I've been at it a while and on my own for a few years, so there's a lot of newness in that as well. I'm also a triathlete, an endurance athlete. And I'll say that it's been a huge impactor of my work-life balance or life balance, giving me an outlet to relieve my stress and keep the train on track. So I'm excited to be here and talk with you all about how our lives are impacted on a day-to-day basis, what we can do to keep ourselves true to ourselves. And, you know, we have one life to live. So thinking about all of those things that are important to us, what are we here to do? So welcome. And I'm going to introduce my panelists, starting with Jen.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Ball with Univision Communications, and I head up the distribution marketing department there. And I'm happy to be here.
Hi, I'm Brie Cassart, and I oversee e-commerce and digital marketing for West Elm.
Hi, I'm Anastasia. I'm an art director at Ready Set Rocket. My entire team is in the front. Yeah, no pressure. So I started here 5 years ago. This is my first job out of college. And, you know, I think no one tells you how hard stress management is and how important of skill it's going to be in your career. So definitely very excited to have this conversation with you guys today.
Hi, I'm Isadora. I'm currently working at Pernod Ricard. I'm senior brand manager on Seagram's Gin. Before that, I worked for about 9 years in the industry, but I was working for another company, luxury company, managed brand like Louis XIII, Louis XIII, and Remy Martin. And for that company, I moved a little bit around the world, lived in South America, in Europe, and came actually to the US. And yeah, I'm very happy to be here.
So how many people, in a show of hands, are in a leadership position in their careers, and how many people are sort of mid-level or junior? Okay, cool. So we have a really nice mix of experience both on the panel and in the room. So we talked about a little bit about this broad statistic of 40% of workers reporting stress on the job. We kind of think it's a little bit higher. Jen, start with you. What are your thoughts on that one?
I definitely think it's higher. I think that's what's reported, right? Because it's not like we walk around talking about, oh my God, I'm so stressed out. But, you know, I think we live in a crazy time, in a crazy world. You know, with technology, we're always on. We're here in New York City, which I think, you know, adds a whole other level of stress, a whole other level of chaos. I think that people are just not open about it, and that's why the 40% is probably much higher than that. So that's my two cents on that statistic.
How about you, Brie?
Absolutely higher. I can't think of a single person in my life that doesn't say they're stressed out on some level. I would agree that I think New York City plays a role in it. I grew up in Colorado, and I don't feel like my parents led quite the stressed out life we do here. And I find that we talk about it at dinner, at drinks. Your work is your job, your work is your life in a lot of respects. And so for better or worse, the stresses of work creep in. They creep into your personal life and they become part of the conversation.
Yeah, I mean, definitely same page. I think I didn't know not being stressed out at work was even an option, so I didn't. I was not aware there were other people. But you know, I think when I first read the question, I was kind of thinking about it. My immediate response was like, "Yeah, I'm totally in the same place." Like, same place. And I think maybe 3 years ago or 2 years ago, when I was just starting out my career, like 100%, my job was the most stressful thing about my life, and it crept up and certainly. But I think, you know, as you get used to anything, as you get more experience, and as, you know, some of these things become a little bit easier to manage, like, it's a lot less overwhelming, and I think that number for me probably goes down a little bit.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with what you said. I think it's, I mean, in my personal opinion, for having started to work so young, I really kept the bar very far, because I felt like I really needed to prove something to, you know, my managers, my bosses. And you know, over the years, I realized that obviously stress started to come, and it was really hard to manage it because I didn't know to do it otherwise. So I mean, I definitely think it's something that over the years you learn how to manage, but it's hard. And I think to what you were saying, Lauren, you kind of sometimes need a wake-up call. You need to have people around you that will do it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Here's the bad news, but not bad news really. Stress, like the whole idea of it being harder when you're younger, the pressures continue throughout, right? Yeah. So yeah, you know, when you first start a job, you want to learn, you want to prove yourself to your manager. When you get to my age, you want to be like the young people because you may not understand the technology or the latest. You know, like when I didn't learn, I know this sounds crazy, I'm probably gonna date myself, but I didn't learn PowerPoint. All these whizzes come in, it's like boom, boom, they can do everything on their laptops. They walk around with their laptops or attached to their laptops. That's not the world that I grew up in. But that adds a layer of stress too. I think it's more about taking a step back and asking yourself, how am I gonna show up here? How am I gonna make myself feel calm so that I can function in this environment? And what kind of environment, as you get to be a leader, am I gonna create for people that it's not gonna be this crazy, stressful life? And I don't mean that you're gonna have people coming to you and talking to you and playing the therapist role. It's more, do you have an open door policy? Can you check in with your manager and say, you know, can we talk about this deadline? I think it's more about how you then show up and deal with your anxiety that you become better at. But the stressors don't change. They just take on different forms. So.
Yeah, and I think, you know, we've kind of played around a little bit in even some of our early parts of this conversation about where the stressors come from and who wants to take that on, where in terms of the course of our entire lives, because the work sits in within our lives. So what level is that work stress compared to everything else? How does that affect our overall health and balance?
So I would say for me, I mean, outside of just like the usual, which is, you know, deadlines and projects and things piling up, I think one of my biggest causes of anxiety was just my own inexperience and just a lack of like confidence in my own abilities that just come inherently with you being a junior in any role. And I just think, you know, it's going to take so much time in order to like gain that confidence, and then once that comes, you're able to handle stress a lot better. And I definitely think in the very beginning, you know, again, like my first 3 or 4 years of my career, that definitely crept in pretty substantially into my personal life because I wasn't able to manage time because I just didn't even know how to do that. I didn't know how long it took to do anything. And so I allowed things at work to really take over my weekends and my evening hours, and I really didn't prioritize anything else. And I think, again, like anything else, that just probably takes, you know, it just takes time to learn those skills, how to prioritize, how to time manage, to understand yourself as an employee and how long it, you know, takes you to do something. And then once you kind of get a good grasp of that, you can start to balance some of the other things in your personal life as well.
Yeah, because one of the things that I've always done throughout the course of my career is help others, my other teammates, reduce stress, prioritize, and stay focused on what's important, what matters. What I liked about that whole process is you really have a check and balance system. there's an accountability involved in that.
I was going to say, I think you know, a lot of it too is asking yourself, like, if you're a person, like, where is the anxiety coming from? Because we were also talking about this idea, like, if you're really happy and you really like what you're doing, a lot of it is, am I in the right culture? You know, because if you're living a life of constant stress, you know, you have to take a step back and say, is this good for me? Do I love what I'm doing enough to put up with this? And would I be less stressed if I was really happy in my career? So I think those are important questions you have to ask yourself.
I think about it as good stress versus bad stress. Mm-hmm. And for me, I think one of the questions we had asked earlier was whether or not stress is helpful in your life, and whether you want stress in your life. And I'm someone who does really well in a fire drill, and the stressful moments propel me forward. But I do think that the opposite end of that is there's bad stress or there's too much of it.
Yeah.
And there have been moments where it's good stress and I'm going. And if you don't take a break, holy crap, like, you're going to burn out. And you have to remind yourself to step back, because then it becomes bad stress when it starts to wear into
it. Right. Well, and there's also stress because you're in a time crunch. Stressed because you don't understand what's being asked of you.
Yeah.
Stressed because there are external factors pushing into it. So how do you break those variables apart on the job?
I think there's what you were saying of not knowing what's expected from you. Mm-hmm. I think for me is the biggest source of stress. If I get in a new job or in a new project and I don't know what's expected from me, or I don't understand it, that's where I get really, really anxious. And it's maybe some kind of insecurity that then develops into anxiety or stress. And this is actually like what triggers it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think what's helpful for me is, well, in this specific example, is really just, you know, if I know that this bothers me, just meeting with my manager and being really open. And you'd be surprised, you know, sometimes it's just like a 5 minutes chat and like, hey, just want to make sure that we're aligned. And it just relieves so much. So I think you don't have to be afraid of doing it. And then for me also is stress is also a pattern. So I know like how it's going to go. So you just have to accept it as well. So when you have like this first feeling where you're like, oh my God, I'm dying, like this is not happening. Like, you have to know that this is going to, you know, pass, and it's fine, and it's gonna go away. But you just also have to accept it, because it usually shows up the same way.
And it's a moment in time.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. It's gonna go away.
But I think that's really important what you said. Like, you know, advocate for yourself, and if a source of anxiety is coming from not knowing what's expected.
Yeah.
You know, take the higher road and go in and be proactive, which bosses will appreciate, right? Your supervisors will appreciate. When I have people come to me and say, what is my priority? I've got these four things. I realize, wow, I should have probably given them their priorities. Thank you for reminding me. Or send them, you know, if you don't, you know, think about how you best want to communicate. Send an email. Here are the four things that, you know, just want to make sure I'm hearing this correctly. Thank you. That's great. And that instantly gives you a sense of, okay, they recognize that I'm listening to them, it's validating, and plus you now are empowered to go do those four things and not question yourself. So I think that's a really simple little thing you can do that goes a long way.
Yeah, one of the other angles to look at this, not everyone has that go-to person. Not everyone has a Jennifer to go to if they are not
I'm
sure.
A really good boss.
So I have my resume. So what advice would you give to someone who's looking for that outlet?
I think it kind of goes to what I was saying. I think we have to, unless you know you're leadership, CEO of a company or something, you always have someone above you that you can talk to. And I think you need to make sure that you don't see that as a weakness. So you have to transfer as well a little bit of this responsibility that you have or this stress, because that's the reason why we have bosses, you know. And I actually recently went through a moment like this where I was totally overwhelmed. I didn't know what to do anymore. And actually talking to someone in my family, they told me, wait, don't you have a boss? And I said, well, actually, I do. So why don't you go and talk to him? Like, it's you know, just simple as that. Like, if you have a boss, he's supposed to step in. And actually, it was super simple. So I think, you know, we need to make sure that you have someone above you, so don't hesitate.
Right.
When you're to your limit, just go and share it and transfer a little bit of this to the person.
Yeah, and
that's why you have managers for it.
How do you see that transforming in the workforce, from your opinions? Do you see that shift happening?
I don't think for all of us it plays out that well. I agree.
Yeah.
If you know that your boss is the kind of person you can take something to, great. Like, I am that kind of person, and I always remind even my staff now, I'm like, I'm listening, but you know, like, when you're going on and complaining, like, not everybody, not that you are complaining, but I'm saying I think you have to assess the situation. And I always say, like, even for myself, like, have a peer, have a buddy, doesn't even have to be someone above you, like, have a trusted person, like, your person that you can go to like, support you, like, in those situations, like, hey, I'm really feeling like X, and I don't know what the expectations are, like, go to that person, because sometimes your boss isn't necessarily the best person, but it really depends,
right.
And you clearly have that kind of boss, but a lot of people don't, so it's something you just have to assess, because a lot of supervisors are uncomfortable. I mean, let's just call it what it is. They're uncomfortable in situations where they're dealing with someone who may be feeling a lot of pressure.
I remember early on in my career having a boss that I could not go to, and I was stressed out. I felt like I couldn't handle the workload. And I was new enough in the company that I didn't know who I could trust and who I could go to. And that's it's a painful moment where you don't know where you can turn. I suppose there are lots of people out there that could be in similar situations where you don't have someone at the office, and in which case, if you don't have a peer, is there someone you can turn to outside of work? And I've found over the course of my career at various points, it's helpful to have people inside. It's great to have a good boss. I'm lucky enough to have a fabulous boss now. But I've cultivated sort of my board of directors, if you will, for my life, and people that I can turn to, depending on what the problem is. It's stress helping me through those moments.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think that conversation, regardless of what kind of relationship you have, is just tough to have in general. Like, even in our agency environment, I think we have a very open door policy. All of our higher ups are immediately available. You always have, you know, you always have the opportunity to grab a coffee or whatever. Like, that's always kind of available to you, and even then, it's still kind of awkward and takes a little bit of time. So, you know, if that is something that is available to you, you should definitely take advantage of it. And if it isn't, you know, tap your outside network. I'm sure your friends are probably in the exact same situation, and if they're not, they might have some great advice. I mean, I've been in plenty of situations where I feel super stressed out, and even in an environment that is really open, like, my immediate reaction wasn't always to go to my bosses. Like, that definitely takes time to develop that rapport and, like, that trust with somebody. So, you know, if you have it, take advantage of it, because they realistically probably don't know that you are stressed out or what's going on.
Or take a deep breath. Like, the other thing, too, is, you know, like, take a deep breath, because, and you said this before, it's like, we've been there before, and chances are, like, you have to avoid, and I to this day, like, have to check in with myself, like, don't react. Like, go out, get out of the office, or say to yourself, I'll deal with this tomorrow, because chances are you may feel very differently the next day, and you don't want to go to maybe the wrong person or say the wrong thing. So there's nothing wrong with, like, taking a beat.
Absolutely not. Which brings me right into my next equation. Stress plus rest equals growth. It's very analogous to triathlon and endurance sports, but really, this is the body that we use to get through all aspects of our lives. How are we fueling it? How are we resting it? And how are we caring for it? That's our mind, our organs, our movement, our nutrition. Sleep is super important for me. But I look at those things, and we're gonna have stress. It's just a fact. are we giving ourselves enough of a break? And what happens on the other side of that, that stressful period? What did we learn? What do we experience? So how do you respond to that after you've come through the other side of a stressful moment? What do you take away from it? Are you giving yourself enough rest and recovery to get back at it again? Because it will happen again.
I go shopping. No, sometimes I do that.
I think my answer to this question is it's less about when I get through on the other side, although I agree, if it's a big project at work and I've spent a lot of time working towards that goal, I do think it's super important to take a day off or take a moment, reward yourself. It's a slightly different equation in my head. It's stress plus reward equals growth. And I guess the reward could come from running or sleeping. Mm-hmm. But I find it really important to take time out every day, just whether it's 30 minutes or an hour, to reward yourself and do something you enjoy in those stressful moments. And it just helps get me over that hurdle and into the finish line.
Yeah, I mean, I think the stressful moments that we've all experienced have probably been those moments that you can actually reflect on and then learn from and then improve, so that you create a template for yourself, so that, you know, the first time you do something and you probably do it poorly, and then you do it again and you do a little bit better but still not to your standard, and so over time you kind of get better and better. But if you don't go through that stress, you're never going to be able to improve on it. And, you know, the rest piece of it, yes, like, I don't, you know, I'm sure most people don't take the time they really need to rest and recover, and it might manifest itself in different ways for different people. But the other piece of it too is probably just like taking a step back and celebrating the fact that, you know, you accomplished something, whether it's something personal for yourself or as a team or as an agency or whatever, like really taking a moment and celebrating the fact that you launched a site or you launched whatever it may be. And then from that moment, looking on to the next and looking at how you can do it better.
Yay! Bravo!
No, I was going to say one thing that's helped me, like, and I learned it in a leadership program about 10 years ago, and it was amazing to me how few people did it, is, and I know this is going to sound cliche, but exercise, like, the mornings that I work out, I am so much more productive and so much less stressed, like, without a doubt. And I think that that's just, it gets the endorphins going, it gets you revved up for the day. It's just really, for me, like, works wonders. But I also agree, like, celebrating successes. And also just give yourself a break. Like, mm-hmm. you know, like, if you had a bad day, you had a bad day. Like, don't beat yourself up about it. I think that's what we all do. Especially if you're, like, I have two children, and when you become a parent and you work, it's like, you just never think you're doing enough. And whether, even if you don't have kids, if you're taking care of a parent, if you went through a hard time, like, just give yourself a break. That goes a long way.
Yeah, I think being hard on yourself, sorry, but it's just like, that's the thing that you get stuck in so much, is that you do one thing and it still wasn't good enough, and then you kind of keep going through this loop, and it's just, you have to break out of that and just take a step back and just, like, you did your best, next time you can improve A, B, and C, and then you try it at that, and, like, you just kind of keep going, because as soon as you, like, just are too hard on yourself, it's never, like, whatever you do is just never going to be good enough, so.
I try to keep it in perspective. I say to my team and to myself often, there are no kidneys in the cooler. You know, we're still captains, we're not saving lives. There are real world problems out there, and we will each have those real world moments that will be hard enough, so be kind to yourself as much as you can.
Yeah.
I do definitely have my share of good habits, and I also have some bad habits. You know, I, like I said, I did have an extremely stressful day, and I walked in the room and I'm like, where can I get a drink? So what are some of the habits, good or bad, that you are your go-tos that get you out of some of these stressful times?
I can't get off my phone. I mean, I think that's probably the worst habit, and I think it was a bad example for my children, too. I mean, I think that's something we're all facing, is like this idea of always having to be on, and I sometimes have to stop myself, and I was saying this before, like, one time I was with my daughter, we were on vacation in Paris, and I was like actually happy when I ran out of battery on my, at the time it was a BlackBerry. I was happy because I didn't, I can't do it anyway, so, you know, I might as well just enjoy the Eiffel Tower, you know. And that's terrible, right? So it's, I think that's my worst habit, and I think it's not good to model to other people and either. So either your colleagues or if you're a supervisor, like, put the phone away. And I have to tell myself that all the time. All the time. At home too.
Oh, it's hard.
Yeah, the phone is a terrible habit. it's hard in an e-commerce world where you're on 24/7, but it is important to put it away. When I drowned my phone, that was when the best day in the last 5 years. It just didn't work for 24 hours.
But it's a relief.
It was just like, oh, nothing I can do about it. Too bad it's the holiday season. Oh well. I agree on the exercise component. I don't know that I would have survived this far if I weren't working out. But I think another just easy thing to do in those moments where I'm overwhelmed at the amount of work or a big project is to just to make a to-do list literally with the checkbox next to it and just start checking things off. It's if you can do one thing to feel productive, at least for me, I feel like I've done something, even if it's answering an email that took 2 minutes, and then I can keep moving forward and checking things off that list, and then all of a sudden it just starts to go away.
Yeah, I mean, exercise, definitely, no doubt about that. I think also just learning how to, just like establishing some good habits, whatever they may be, and that help you be a little bit more productive or sane throughout the day. So whether, you know, you like bookmark your day or bookend your day or whatever, like plan out your calendar so you know what you have happening for the day, how to pace out your projects where they're not overwhelming and you can, you know, work in, you know, 2 hour blocks and then take a clean break and then start on something else. Just figuring, like, finding those ways that really work for you, and then, you know, sticking to them as best as possible because you know that's what's going to help you get through your day. The other thing I realized as I kind of kept working is that, you know, I was always, if I was late on something, I would work really, really late. And then eventually I learned over time that I was actually a lot more productive in the morning. So I shifted my days around quite a bit so that now if I'm like running late on a project, I'm not, you know, up at 10 o'clock at night, like moving pixels around and not getting anything done. Like I know if I can just get started earlier, then I'll be a lot more productive. So just like finding those small little things for yourself that work better for you. And again, those just take time to figure out about yourself.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I've only introduced, actually, I think, good habits recently. I probably have all the bad habits that exist. Probably not the drinking, but it's because I work in a spirits company, so that would be really bad. But the good habits for me, yeah, working out or doing some kind of activity, physical activity, is just key. I think also what really helped me is having something that helps you nurture your self-knowledge. So, you know, I found that there's so many different activities. I mean, I'm a big advocate of meditation. There's also therapy, you know, reading, playing an instrument. I think that all those things really enable you to have a better understanding of what you are, of what your limits are, of what you're looking for, and enables you really to take a distance and really be more of a spectator sometime. And I feel like this is key for handling stress.
Mm-hmm.
The one bad habit I have actually is that I get super motivated on like Monday morning or whatever, and I book out all of these activities for myself to do, and then I fail on all of them because I just don't have the motivation to actually do them. So as long as I like stick to one, I feel accomplished, but I know that it just takes me getting somewhere, and I know that it's going to be worth it, and it's going to make me feel so much better. So just making sure that you carry through on your commitments is really important, because for me that's a big thing. I fail a lot.
You know, we talked a little bit about self-management, and wanted to tackle this from both ends, actually, from a leadership perspective. What I mean, we're all in the room together. A lot of us are in open office environments, for example. So how you show up in your workforce environment, that's one of the things we talked about prior to the conversation. What are some of the examples you can set as a leader or as a mid-level manager to your colleagues about self-managing stress?
I think it's important to very simply take time off, or whether it's taking lunch or taking a vacation. I think, Lauren, you touched on it in the beginning where you didn't take a vacation in the first 5 years of your life. But as a leader, I think it's really important to set that example that you're making time for yourself, your friends, your family. Leave at 6 o'clock, a few nights a week at least. Go to dinner with your friends. Make time for your family. And I think that projects how they should, how your team should live their life.
I think checking in with people is something that's really important. And I don't think people do it enough. And even at the highest levels, you know, I have somebody in my team now who's dealing with some personal stuff, and like I always ask, if he doesn't want to tell me, that's fine, but at least he knows that I'm concerned. So I think creating that environment of making people feel like they can check in, just even about the personal things that are going outside of the office, is one thing. What's the question again?
Totally lost my train of thought.
Just what are the examples that we can set for self-managing our stress?
Oh, the other thing I was going to say, thank you, is you know, you may want to ask to the point of like, how do we show up? Sometimes you may want to seek the advice of, you know, again, maybe it's a peer or somebody outside of your direct like support group that can give you, or even your boss actually, that can give you feedback in stressful situations, like how did I handle that? Because sometimes there's blind spots, and I've learned this the hard way, that when we're really stressed, like one thing like I do, I know, is I withdraw. And that can look physical, it can look like blank stare when you don't know what's going on. So, but we're not always aware of those blind spots, so I think it's really important to have, to seek feedback. Feedback is the biggest gift you can get. And I think it's important to either, whether it's your supervisor or a peer, anybody that can give you that information to help you learn how to better show up in stressful situations, I think is really important.
Yeah, definitely. And I think the other thing too is, for myself, I'm moving into more of a leadership position now, and I think the best thing that I learned and is knowing sort of your boundaries and when you need to, one, either like say no because you just can't fit any more stuff, or try like ask for help to help you reprioritize or move things around to make your time more manageable. And I think a lot of people in more junior roles are afraid to ask for that help because they feel like it's an expectation that they need to deliver on everything across the board. And it's not always apparent that that's actually not the expectation. Like, your managers don't expect you to do all of these things. They just think that it might be possible because you didn't say anything. And I can't stress how important it is to, if you feel like you can't do all of it, just say that. And I feel like time and time again, I've kind of seen that come, like, be very successful when I'm vocal about the fact that I can't handle something. And I think for people in more of a junior role, like, they should feel empowered to bring those things forward and say, like, no, I can't do that, or I need help making sure that I get all these things done.
Yeah, but agree with all of that. I feel like the support as well, team that you have, so team or friends at work, is just key so you don't feel isolated. I feel like when you feel isolated is when you start to feel anxiety. It's what they say with great teams, great results, right? So I think it's key for you to really have people around so you don't feel, have this feeling.
Any other key takeaways, giveaways that you want to share?
I do try to check in, which you made a good point about, but I think it can sometimes be obvious if there's someone has a big project and you can very easily say, how's it going? How are you feeling about it? If, you know, I had someone on my team recently who was dealing with a difficult direct report underneath her, and I know it was a hard situation for her, and I made time on a weekly basis to just say, how's it going? I know it's hard. You're doing a great job. And I think there's something to be said about just ongoing encouragement for teams. And then I think the point you made about expectations, and it's interesting because I agree in my early early days, I did everything. I did it, you know, I worked all hours, and I thought the expectation was to get it all done. And now that I'm in a leadership position, I'm surprised at the number of people who tell me they can't, and that's perfectly okay. And I could have been saying that too, that I can't do all of this. I need to prioritize, and this is going to have to wait until next week. It can't happen tomorrow. And I think just knowing that that's okay, it's okay not to get everything done immediately, and to talk to your boss. It's super important just to remember that fact. It's okay. You are human.
Hooray. Hooray for humanity. it's been a really great journey and conversation tonight, and I think we could go on and peel back more and more layers, but I think, the idea of creating that support system, the buddy system, and being okay with who you are, where you are in the room, where you are in your career, that you have nothing to lose if it's you, it's your life. So if you need something, find that outlet, find that resource that's gonna help you get to where you need to go. We can never do anything alone. So thanks so much for everyone's time. Do we have any questions for the panel?
Choosing the culture you want to create for your team and being empowered to do that and making a decision for yourself about the culture you want to belong to. I'm a firm believer in that. Like, I think when you turn the table and give yourself the power to make those choices, it changes the picture, and you're not like, and I ask myself that all the time. Like, the culture I want to create, is that the culture that I am looking at for myself? So, if you're in a crazy, hectic world and it's like no fun anymore, then the bigger question is, do I want to be here? I mean, I'm taking it to a very serious level, but I feel very strongly about culture in general, because we spend so much time at work, So I surround myself with people that I really like. I surround myself with people that we talk about things other than work and talk about our families, because that's important to me. And I work for people like that. If you're not getting what you need, then I think you have to ask yourself, is this the right place for me?
Hi. So I haven't fully processed my question yet, but so I had a conversation a couple of years ago with a former colleague about whether you're a career person or like a non-career person in terms of how you prioritize what's important to you. Kind of pulling the stress in, and I tend to be a very stressed out person, and in the last year or so I've experienced some intense stress that resulted in me feeling kind of like I was broken and had to pull out of that job opportunity and take some rest and then pursue the next opportunity. And I kind of wonder, do any of you have a kind of take on whether you feel like somebody who's focused outside of your career to find a balance between the stress and everything, where you feel that you have that balance between personal life and work?
For me, that's been a constant roller coaster ride, and I think I was 12 years into my career and started doing Ironmans to escape the career thing, and started a whole new career doing sports. I mean, I had a whole community coming out of that, but we're not on this one singular track through graduating college all the way through to the time that we die. Our interests and our needs are going to change over and over again. it's okay to experiment and discover new things about yourself. That's just part of the journey.
I was gonna say, you know, when I had my son, which was a long time ago, I was in this debate with myself, like, oh my God, you know, to the my career, am I gonna go back to work? Am I gonna be home? I felt really guilty, you know, the things that a lot of women go through. And I remember talking to my mother, and she, back to the mom, right? She said, gave me the best advice. She said, a good mother is a happy mother. So if you turn the table and say, you know, and I know this sounds very kind of almost corny, but it's about what is fulfilling to you and what gives you happiness. So if you don't look at it as like, am I a career person, am I that person? I mean, look at it more like, what do I enjoy doing? And maybe that will be your career.
It's interesting too, like we talk a lot about purpose and meaning in the marketing world, and you know what, you know, but we don't do it for ourselves. You know, what's our purpose? What's my purpose? What's my mission in life?
But I think that's where, I think you were saying before,
yeah.
Like I do a lot of volunteer work at an organization called Strive, and I feel really, and I have another project that's really of interest to me right now around the mental health field, and I think that giving yourself other outlets can also align with your career in some
mm-hmm.
cases, but I think it's really important just to make you a richer person.
Yeah, but and I mean, adding on this, I think it's okay for you not to know, you know? I think
yeah.
it's really like not knowing if you want to be a career person. I think it's really about also like seizing opportunities and really what makes
fulfills you
happy. And this, I mean, for me, it has, and it's still been something quite difficult because I'm, you know, always challenged and saying, okay, but so do I go for a title or do I go for learning? And, you know, I'm always like struggling between those questions, but I feel at the end of the day, you need to know, is the title going to bring you this fulfillment that you're looking for? Or is the money, or is the, you know, people that you work for, and you need to identify that and go. And there's something that never fails, is the little feeling here. The gut feeling is just, I think it never fails. I mean, that's my experience.
Mm-hmm. Any
it's
other
journey.
Thoughts or
yeah.
opinions?
I was just gonna say, it's a journey about figuring it out.
Yeah.
To your point, you don't have to know, you can explore,
yeah.
you'll find your way. Be patient with yourself.
Since we're a room full of women, how do you handle the just kind of underlying stress of becoming a more either just middle management or leadership role as a woman? You're maybe surrounded in a marketplace that's predominantly men. Just how does that affect your stress level and how you handle that in ways that are different than what you've already discussed? I work with a bunch of men, so I'm not saying.
Unfortunately, or fortunately, I work with a lot of women, and that has just been a real blessing. And I'm a new mother, and I work with a lot of moms, so I've got an incredible support network just at my office. So I don't have specific advice for you in that, but it's something I think about, especially as we bring on more men into the organization. How does that work out? Because I do think that there are different, for better or worse, and I think things are evolving. There are different pressures on women, whether it's age or motherhood or you're the person who has to bring the cupcakes to the office. It is something real, and it's something to be cognizant of. I wish I had some advice maybe one of these women could share with you.
Yeah, I work in a quite masculine industry, and obviously loses. Mostly men. I feel like what has helped me, and actually I was trying to remember the name of the article that I read a few weeks ago, and it was basically talking about the things that women have, you know, that men don't, and you know, about really finding this balance. So you know, this about how women can be, you know, not generalizing, but like can be a little bit more like altruist, you're saying?
Altruistic?
Yeah. Yes. This.
That thing.
But,
oh, that.
women have, and that we really have to use that, like the sensibility, or, you know, it's not negative. It's not negative for you to feel, you know, it's fine. So I think that's how I've handled it, in, you know, just saying, well, you know, I have stuff that you don't have, and you have stuff that I don't have, and that's just, you know, that's how we're gonna work. Just obviously setting limits and all of this. Things that we all know.
I did do a consulting project with a creative agency in Brooklyn a year and a half ago. Four male partners. Two of them I knew very well, and were actually good friends. Another one did not trust me at all. And there was very much of a bro culture that I was kind of working with, and had to change my dialogue and change the way I presented information so that I could get through. But it only got through to a certain point, because they did want to convert me to a full-time position that I didn't want. So once that door closed, I had zero access to any operational decision-making or development within the organization. And that's a very, it may not be an atypical situation, but it was a smaller organization of about 25 people. I felt that glass ceiling could get lower and lower and lower and lower. And, you know, there are moments that those things still happen. Fortunately, I've worked with a lot of male-dominant organizations that have, you know, if they're more creative environments, or you've got a little bit more of a right brain ecosystem, you've got a little bit more room to play. You really have to study the mindset of the organization and the culture that's being created. There's a lot of my observation, and this could go into a whole other territories, but there's a misogyny in a little bit in all of us. You know, women certainly have their own preconceived notions just from culture of, oh, well, I don't think I have the right to speak up, or I don't have the right to ask for this. You know, who says? You know, but these are things that we've created for ourselves inadvertently, and I think men still, while they think that, yeah, we're definitely equal in the workforce, it's not always demonstrated. I think there's a lot of room for us to play and experiment with that, testing our boundaries.
Yeah, that's a big topic.
It's a big topic.
A whole other session.
Yeah.
You're doing another one tomorrow, right?
Yeah. So we'll be down at Vaughn for a few weeks after. Hi.
Hello. Thank you guys so much for the conversation. My question is about opportunity costs. How do you approach a situation or a moment in time when you have a feeling about what you're passionate about, what your purpose is? We talked a lot about purpose tonight. But it's not necessarily the thing that can pay the bills, or not necessarily the thing that people at this time will pay you for. And living in a city like New York, it's hard to just say, like, follow your purpose, find what that makes you happy, because that's not what's going to keep the lights on with you necessarily.
So that's a great point, and that's what I mentioned before, because, you know, I have a similar situation where, yeah, I need to work, and what I love and what I'm passionate about is not going to pay the bills. So how do you integrate the two? So how do you spend your free time doing something that's really fulfilling and giving back, and thinking even in your work life, like, what experience can I take here that can maybe help me over here? And I actually do, like, in the organization that I volunteer, one of the things that I do is I help this organization. I bring in, like, without going into what they do, but I've helped them with fundraising events by bringing in honorees on the corporate level. Like, I try to give back while also incorporating my professional life. So I think there's ways to do it. You just have to be creative and maybe set the mindset that it's not either or. Because when you do that, I think then it's limiting. You can have both.
Yeah, it's probably too. I would imagine, like, wherever you're at, there's probably other people on your team or amongst you that are also kind of looking to do those things outside of work to find more fulfillment as well. So maybe just finding the people that you work with that share those same passions or finding those similarities that potentially, you know, you are able to extend your skill set outside of the office to something that is, you know, more of a personal project or something that you feel a different sense of passion for. So maybe just like finding those people within your community or network or organization that you can kind of buddy up with and work with.
She's back.
There's
some timid hands. Kind of coming back to what I was initially thinking about, like, so you have work and then you have your passions outside of work, but then how do you carve out the time for self-care?
Well, the passions outside of work can also be a form of self-care, I think. I mean,
like sleep and like cooking. I think you have to
prioritize just like you would at work.
Yeah.
For me, I don't function on less than 6 hours of sleep. I know that about myself. So sleep rises to the top of my priority list. For better or worse, exercise, as much as I love it and need it, slides down a little bit in favor of sleep on those days. So I think you just have to know what's going to be the most valuable to you and how you to best take care of yourself. Prioritize accordingly. So if it's out, you know, the volunteer activity, the exercise, the sleep, the cooking. Unfortunately, I think it's very difficult to have it all. It would be lovely if you could. I certainly have not figured out how to do it all. So.
And at different points in time in your life, you're not. I mean, when my kids were younger, I didn't do any of the things that I'm able to do now. Pre-kids, I was able to do more volunteer work and pursue interests. So. It's also what's happening in your life at that moment in time. Because having a family adds a whole other layer of obligations and stress.
For those two, you're also like, you're able to create your own deadlines in those kind of situations. So it's not like you have to stick to a date or whatever. Like you can carve out your own kind of timeline for something to get it done so that you can make sure that you do have the time to allocate to a personal project while also making time for cooking or working out, whatever that is, whatever you need to be doing.
Hi.
Hi. Thanks so much for sharing tonight. So my question is, if you, regardless of the culture you work in, if you are in a leadership position, how do you sort of encourage direct reports to be energized by stress? And it seems like you know, it's something that's affecting everyone. How do you sort of turn into a positive?
See, we're gonna get this done. It's gonna be great.
How do you cheerlead? Yeah.
Lots of arms.
I mean, I do think that attitude. I mean, I'm not like that, but I do think that, like, you know, making. It's how you present things and how you deliver the, if you go in and you say, oh my God, we've got this horrible situation and we've got this, you know, as a leader, you gotta be, this is gonna be great. I know this is gonna take a lot of people's time and, you know, we're gonna probably be here all night, but I know this, I know you guys can do this. I know we're gonna get it done. I'm gonna be right here. I mean, I think there's ways that you, it's all how you position it, in my opinion, because I'm one of those people, I work at a network, you know how many times we've had to like pull signals and go dark and alert, you know, we've literally have been in crisis situations and we're on the line for getting really good results. And you know, sometimes the energy is like, we're gonna do this and then we actually do it and people start seeing it and it's like they forget about all the stress that they went through. So it's, I think it's how you get your team motivated. Bring in lunch while you're working, you know, like, okay, we're gonna just work through lunch. Like, little things like that go a long way.
I think it's also partially about showing people how they can impact something.
Yep.
If you're just asking them to do it, but not demonstrating or giving them a goal and what the impact is, it's really hard to be motivated.
Yeah.
But understanding even the smallest thing can drive business or make an impact on a presentation or a client, and then rewarding it.
Yeah, I had a boss that every time he knew that he crossed the line a little bit or he went too deep on the stress, he would buy us little vouchers for Manny Petties and his favorite place, the one that he went to. Tip included. not tip our any tips. But you know, little things like this work. Because then you know you're like, oh, okay.
Like they appreciate.
Yeah, you know that you're appreciated and you know that this was the effort or this trust wasn't for anything.
Giving credit where credit is due in front of people is also very valuable.
Thank you and acknowledgement. It's as simple as that. And it doesn't have to be fun to be fun. So you, a little bit of encouragement. I got that from one of my coaches. You know, you go through something hard, you're like, but we're going to get out of this on the other side as a team, and we're going to be better and stronger together. And but somehow you kind of get through it, and you're like, yeah, we just did that. We did that. And it's a good feeling to get a mission accomplished.
And I think if you know, like, you're going to be thanked on the other side, you know, I think that's also motivating.
For sure.
Like, I know they're going to appreciate what I'm about to do, you know.
Thanks, everyone. Really
Thank
appreciate
you.
The time.